In the previous videos, we covered the bone anatomy of the vertebral column, ribs, and the sternum. Together, they form a solid cage around the heart and lungs. But the thorax also needs to move with every breath you take. It expands and contracts with every breath. To let that happen safely, that's where the joints come in. So the way we're going to cover them is by first look at the joints between the ribs and the vertebral column back there. We're going to look at the joints along the rib shaft and the joints between the ribs and the sternum. What's up everyone? My name is Taim. I'm a medical doctor and I make animated medical lectures to make different topics in medicine visually easier to understand. If you would like a PDF version or a quiz of this presentation, you can find it on my website along with organized video lectures to help with your studies. Alright, let's get started. So let's start with the joints between the ribs and the vertebral column. And for this, let's isolate the vertebrae, two ribs, and look at the joints. In general, there are two major joints here that we need to talk about. One is called the joint of the head of the rib, and the other one is the costovertebral joints. Let's look at this a little bit closer. The joint of the head of the rib is here. This is a synovial joint, and the articulating surfaces are the head of the rib, which usually has two articulating facets, as you see here. These connect to the superior costal facet of the vertebrae below and the inferior costal facet of the vertebrae above, with the intervertebral disc sitting between them. So one rib head typically touches two vertebrae. This setup gives the thoracic cage its stability, but this joint is actually supported by two main ligaments. First, we have the radiate ligament. It spreads out from the anterior surface of the rib head and attaches to both the vertebrae and the disc. It basically locks the joint down from the front. Then there's the intra-articular ligament, which connects the ridge between the two articular facets of the rib to the intervertebral disc, and that divides the joint into two compartments. This ligament is only present when the rib has two facets, so typically absent in ribs like 1, 10, 11, and 12. Both of these ligaments work together to stabilize the joint, but still allow for that slight rotation the rib needs when you breathe. Now, let's move on to the second joint, the costotransverse joint. This one is located between the tubercle of the rib and the transverse process of the vertebrae at the same level. So this is a simpler one-to-one articulation. It's also a synovial joint and allows slight gliding movements. That gliding varies though depending on the rib. Upper ribs rotate more and lower ribs glide more. The costovertebral joints is held in place by three supporting ligaments. First is the costotransverse ligament, which connects the neck of the rib to the transverse process. Then we have the superior costotransverse ligament, which runs up to the transverse process of the vertebrae above. And the lateral costotransverse ligament that connects the tubercle of the rib to the tip of the transverse process. If some of these ligaments are injured, like a blunt trauma or a rib fracture, pain in these areas can often be mistaken for back or muscular pain. So, that's it for the joints between the ribs and the vertebral column. Next, let's move on to the joints along the rib shaft. What does that mean? Basically, these are joints located between the different parts of the rib cage, not at the spine, not at the sternum, but in between, along the rib itself. These joints help connect the ribs to the costal cartilages and even connects the cartilages to each other. The first one on the list are costochondral joints. Where are the costochondral joints? Here you see the costal cartilage, here's the rib, and in between them is the costochondral joint, basically where these two meet. Those are synchondrosis, so they're cartilaginous joints. So the way this works is that essentially the rib and its cartilage are fused by hyaline cartilage. This type of joints doesn't allow any movement. It's strong and rigid, which makes sense because we don't want this part of the rib cage flexing too much. All the ribs have these joints, so this connection exists from the first rib all the way down to the 10th. After the 10th, the ribs are floating and don't connect to the costal cartilage in the same way. Alright, then we have the interchondral joints, and here you can see them highlighted. These are the joints between the costal cartilage of the ribs 6 through 10. Unlike the costochondral joints, these are usually synovial, meaning they do allow for a bit of gliding movement that actually help your rib cage expand during breathing, especially when taking deep breaths. Some of these joints can ossify with age, and that can make the rib cage feel stiffer in older people. Now, I want to point out that there are also two membranes here that are not joints, but they are still important in this area. In between the ribs, we got something called the external intercostal membrane. This membrane is a continuation of the external intercostal muscles and covers the front part of the intercostal space. The external intercostal muscles themselves run obliquely down and forward, and they help lift the ribs during inspiration. Deep to them, we have the intercostal muscles, which run in the opposite direction, so downwards and backwards, and they help with forced expiration by pulling the ribs downwards. On the posterior end, we can see the internal intercostal membrane, which is the posterior continuation of the internal muscles near the vertebrae. These membranes aren't joints by definition, but they're tightly linked to the rib movement and function, so definitely worth mentioning. So that was it for the joints along the rib shaft. Let's now do the joints between the ribs and the sternum. So now we are looking at the joints where the front of the ribs meet the sternum, and we will go through them one by one. First is the first rib joint. This is a synchondrosis, so it's a cartilaginous, immovable joint, basically a firm, direct attachment between the first rib and the manubrium of the sternum. This one is unique because the other ribs don't use this type of joints. The rest of the true ribs, that is ribs 2 through 7, connect to the sternum through what we call sternocostal joints. These are synovial joints, which means they do allow movement, and that is super helpful for the ribcage to expand and contract. Other joints in this area, we can see the manubriosternal joint, located between the manubrium and the body of the sternum. This is a symphysis, so it's a slightly movable joint made of fibrocartilage. It forms the sternal angle, which you can often feel on yourself. Fun fact, it's used as a landmark in clinical exams to locate the second rib. Below that is the xiphoid joint. It's also a symphysis, and it's between the body of the sternum and the xiphoid process. This joint tends to ossify with age, so it becomes less mobile over time. Now, there are also a couple of supporting structures that are worth mentioning here as well. First up is the radiate sternocostal ligament. You can see it here. It spreads out like a fan from the costal cartilage to the sternum, reinforcing the front of the sternocostal joints. Then we have the sternal membrane, which covers the front of the sternum and helps stabilize all of these joints. So that's it for all the joints between the ribs and the breastbone. And with that, we've covered all the main joints of the thoracic cage. That means we have officially gone through all the bones and joints of the axial skeleton in the skeletal video series, including the skull, the thorax, and the vertebral column. Next up, we're going to begin covering the bones and joints of the upper limb. Starting from the top of the list, we will go through the clavicle, scapula, humerus, radius, ulna, and the bones of the hand. So the next video will be about the clavicle. Click the next video to continue learning, and I'll see you there. And if you want handmade PDF version of this lecture, take a quiz to test your knowledge, or access an organized list of all my videos, you can find everything on my website. Thanks for watching, see you in the next one.